Okay, we'll start with this. Well, I'm sure that most of you have heard already. The long-anticipated and long-postponed fight between Mayra Spritas and Junior Gorticos, the cruiserweight final of the World Boxing Super Series, is finally underway for later on this month on September 26th, and it's going to be taking place in Munich as opposed to Latvia. That particular Saturday promises to be an action-packed weekend of boxing, as we're going to have the cruiserweight final between two explosive fighters, and later on that night here in the States, we're going to have that Charlo doubleheader, Jermall Charlo versus Sergey Diviatchenko, and Jermall Charlo versus Jason Rosario for three of the four major titles in the junior middleweight division. And this fight, in spite of having been postponed as long as it has, is no less a crapshoot. It's no less a tough fight to call, because while Mira Spritas might arguably have the better resume of these two fighters, Junior Gorticos does pack one-hitter, quitter power. There are several questions hanging over this matchup that have everything to do with its outcome. Can Junior Gorticos land that big right hand of his? And if he does, does Mira Spritas have the intestinal fortitude and the durability here and now to absorb it and keep on fighting? As both of these fighters have different sweet spots. Mira Spritas does his best work mid-range to inside, whereas Junior Gorticos, like many fighters that have a lot of reach, needs to get full extension on the punch in order to generate that devastating power. Though if he does, I happen to think there are very few cruiserweights out there who can stand up to it. In layman's terms, can Mira Spritas get mid-range to inside on Junior Gorticos without being caught? And what if Junior Gorticos takes the stance, takes the approach that he took with Andrew Tabidi, where he's firing straight shots from the outside, coming in, getting on the front foot, and being the aggressor?
Can Mira Spritas deal with that?
That's the question. Junior Gorticos very much looked a man alive against Andrew Tabidi. The problem here, however, is that was a while ago. We know that a lot has happened since then. There have been delays, there have been postponements, and one is left to wonder if this is going to have a tangible effect on the fighter's ability to perform. In truth, I can't fault anyone for either picking Mira Spritas or Junior Gorticos to win this thing. It is a crapshoot. I mean, even outside of the delays, even outside of the postponements, a guy who packs the kind of punch that Junior Gorticos packs is a guy you can't overlook. But at the same time, Mira Spritas really is a skilled operator, one of the more skilled operators in this entire division. You could argue he gave Usyk the very best fight Usyk's ever gotten. This promises to be a titillating matchup, regardless of its outcome, regardless of how it ends. It's just a great pity that the cruiserweight division is once again split. It is once again divided. There aren't as many world titles on the line in this cruiserweight final of the World Boxing Super Series as originally planned. I mean, now, Arsene Goulamarian is the WBA champion. Lunga Makabu is the WBC champion. We know Junior,
he's there,
part of it, but WBO, that's gone vacant. Aww. That title will be contested between Lawrence Okoli and Christoph Glowacki when the time comes. A lot has happened since Mira Spritas locked horns with Christoph. The WBO title was on the line in that fight, and things have changed. The situation has changed due to a ruling from the WBO in reference to how that Spritas versus Glowacki fight was officiated. And it's a great pity, because one of the primary functions the World Boxing Super Series has brought to boxing is consolidation, the consolidation of world titles, establishing an authority figure in a given weight class. But here in the cruiserweight division, that function is absent, as regardless of who wins this match, the division is still split. It is still divided. It's not like what we saw when Usyk was here. In any event, this does promise to be a very exciting match. Anything can happen. If I'm being honest, I'd be surprised if this thing does go the distance. I'm looking forward to the long-anticipated World Boxing Super Series Cruiserweight Final between Mira Spritas and Junior Gorticos. In lightweight news, Devin Haney posted this via his Twitter account, and it reads, "I got the 1.5, Mr. Gary Russell Jr. No stipulations, rematch clause only. I'm ready to beat your ass. At Eddie Hearn, at DAZN USA." And this is in reference to some blustering from Garden Gnome Gary that There may have been stipulations in the contract or whatever it is, and he just wants a one-off. He just wants that one fight for that $1.5 million. I still don't know that this fight materializes because, I reiterate, I don't take Gary Russell Jr.'s recent candor very serious. I'll have to see it to believe it, as this is the same Gary Russell Jr. who in May of last year, after fighting Kiko Martinez, said that he wants the Gervonta Davis fight, he wants the Leo Santa Cruz fight, and he would immediately, emphasis on immediately,
right,
he would immediately vacate his WBC featherweight title and move up to the super featherweight division to challenge Miguel Burchell.
Did you forget?
Gary didn't show any follow-up on that. That was the night that Gary Russell Jr. issued out an ultimatum to Al Haymon, an ultimatum that he was wearing on the back of his robe.
What's up, Al?
Didn't show any follow-through that time, but I'm supposed to believe that he is going to show follow-through this time. After the Kiko Martinez fight, did he vacate his WBC title? Did he move up to the super featherweight division? No. He stood right there at featherweight, where he's been, and ended up fighting Tuksak Niambiar in defense of the title he said he was going to vacate.
Oh, but I'm supposed to believe him now, right?
In truth, there are probably more even contests, more even matchups out there for Devin Haney, aside from this one. Essentially, Gary Russell Jr. would be moving up two weight classes for this fight. He'd be moving up from 126 past 130 to 135. Oh. I would much rather have seen Devin Haney versus the winner of Linares versus Fortuna if that fight had come off, but it didn't.
Jorge ended up getting COVID.
There are other names out there like Ivan Mendy, Emmanuel Togo, more solid, more proven fighters at 135 pounds than Gary Russell Jr. would be the night of a proposed Devin Haney fight. There is the name of the former IBF champion, Richard Comey, to also consider, though Richard hasn't had a fight since he was brutally knocked out by Teofimo Lopez, so one is left to wonder how much credit would Devin Haney even get for fighting that guy under those circumstances. I'm not saying he's going to get a whole heap of credit for fighting Gary Russell Jr. In all likelihood, he might not get any. But what he will get is attention. And that by no means adds value to the scalp of Gary Russell Jr. in a competitive sense, in a lightweight sense, where this fight would presumably be fought.
It don't.
Gary Russell Jr. would be just as out of place at 135 as Mikey Garcia was at 147, and Kell Brook and Amir Khan were in the middleweight division. It is that kind of a situation. But if the people at Matchroom are going for this, it must be due to the attention Devin would get fighting Gary as opposed to fighting lesser-known fighters like Ivan Mendy, Emmanuel Togo, so on and so forth.
Not a single one of them are household names.
But, relatively speaking, Gary Russell Jr. is more well-known than either of those two guys. Relatively speaking, of course, because Gary Russell, he's no Julio Iglesias either. And I think that if there even is an expressed desire out there to see this fight materialize, it's because the boxing fans want somebody to shut Gary the fuck up. I mean, if they want to see this thing, it really has to be for that reason. Because beating Gary Russell Jr. at lightweight doesn't mean a goddamn fucking thing. But if you can get this little garden gnome to shut his fucking pie hole,
that really would be satisfying.
Of course, the guy's been running his mouth nonstop for weeks about...
Terrence, what's up, man? You wild as shit for trying to send that man that little bit of money. He ain't gonna take the fight. I fight you for what you offer, Kell Brook. It's not about the money at this point. It ain't about the money. Now I just wanna fuck you up. I just want to put my hands on you, man.
What he'll do to Crawford, about what he'll do to Haney, and when you cross-reference what he's saying with what he's actually been doing, it's just a lot of talk. I'd consider this fight a guilty pleasure. Very much a guilty pleasure. It's in the same realm, it's in the same scope as Mikey Garcia daring to be great against Errol Spence, and Rigo daring to be great against Loma. Kell Brook and Amir Khan going up there to middleweight, getting their asses handed to him. I mean, this is in the same arena as all of those fights. It's just that this fight is a guilty pleasure because I really do want someone to shut Garden Gnome Gary the fuck up.
Shut him the fuck up, man.
Told you, I don't know how much credit you can give Devin Haney for winning this thing, even in spectacular fashion, assuming he does. But if he does, it will be a guilty pleasure to finally see someone get Gary to close his fucking mouth.
And finally, Top Rank has wheeled out their October schedule for what fights we can expect to see that month. Starting off is the Jose Zapata versus Ivan Bedenchik fight, a fight that promises to be a barn burner. That's set to be going down October 3rd on ESPN+. On October 9th, Emmanuel Navarrete versus Ruben Villa for what is now the vacant WBL featherweight title. Originally, it was going to be Jesse Magdaleno, but Jesse wasn't happy with the money. Enter Ruben Villa. That promises to be a good fight as well. I've said it before and I'll say it again. I think Emmanuel Navarrete has what it takes to become a world champion in a second weight class. I think he's got the size to fill out and his power has transferred over. I think that Ruben Villa fight promises to be a fire fight. On October 17th, the highly anticipated lightweight contest between Vasyl Lomachenko and Teofimo Lopez. A contest that is getting mixed reviews as far as, is it really for the undisputed lightweight championship, when you know what? There is dispute. The dispute of Devin Haney's status as a champion and how that came into being. Whether you like it or not, whether I like it or not, this guy is in possession of a world title. And because he's in possession of a world title, regardless of how he got it, there's dispute. The ideal solution in this scenario would be for the winner to lock horns with Devin Haney, but therein lies the dilemma. Due to the politics of boxing, there are no guarantees that Devin Haney gets a crack at the winner of Lopez versus Loma. I'm being honest, I think we'd sooner see Devin Haney fight Gary Russell Jr. than the winner of that fight. I don't know why, but there seems to be a growing mob of disgruntled boxing fans with Devin Haney as if he is somehow responsible for his current predicament. The reality of it is, if you're looking for someone to blame, you blame Top Rank, you blame the WBC. Now, they're not going to do this. For excitement, for enthusiasm that the fight between Lomachenko and Lopez is coming off. But regardless of that, I mean, I'm excited about that fight too, but that doesn't change the sequence of events that led us here. That if there is dispute, any dispute, however big or small it is to you, it's as a result of Top Rank's actions. It's as a result of what options were made available to them by the WBC and their proliferation of designations and trinket titles. It's their fault. Devin Haney can't be emailed anything without Top Rank petitioning for franchise status and the WBC creating that status out of the clear blue sky in the first fucking place.
What? You want to see more belts in boxing?
Because there ain't enough of them as it is. We need more to make the sport even harder to follow and even harder to understand for the casual audience, for the casual observer.
Boxing fans are wishy-washy.
And whilst jumping for joy that Lomachenko versus Lopez is finally underway, they're not realizing how this hurts the sport, how these continued practices from the powers that be over a long enough timeline dilute the sport to the point where it's far too confusing for the casual observer to be engaged by it. You've got any number of guys in a given weight class running around calling themselves world champions, and in a lot of cases, they're not wrong.
But what are you gonna do?
Between the powers that be and the sanctioning bodies that cater to them, lest we forget the cornflakes, the wishy-washy boxing fans that pick and choose what they want to be outraged about, can't keep the same energy on the exact same given subject. These things happen. Overall, it's a great fight. I'm looking forward to it, but is rather contentious as to whether or not this really is an undisputed lightweight title fight. On Friday, October 23rd, Artur Beterbiev will be defending his title versus Adam Dinez. This really isn't his mandatory challenger, Fan Long Meng.
He had visa issues.
So he's going to be fighting this guy instead, though in truth, neither one of those opponent options are going to grab anybody's attention until it's Artur Beterbiev versus somebody else at the weight with a belt.
Won't be as intriguing.
Artur Beterbiev is the most destructive puncher at this weight. I think here today there is very little doubt in anyone's mind of that. And anything short of a B-ball being opposite the ring of him is going to seem like a formality. In truth, maybe this is an evil, but it's a necessary evil. This is the first fight Artur will have had since unifying the titles way back when against Oleksandr Vozdik. That seems like almost an age ago. So Artur's got to get out there like anybody else, shake off the cobwebs, and get his juices going. I have nothing against the fight, nothing against the opponent option. I just know that it's not the kind of fight that's really going to grab anybody's attention. And as if you needed any further indication that the Naoya Inoue versus John Riel Casimiro fight is dead, on October
Fighty Feist. Okay. Oh, he's going to be defending his title against Jason Maloney on ESPN Plus. We've heard a lot of reports that, you know, John Riel, he may be moving up in weight. He may be targeting Luis Neri for a fight. September 26th, on the undercard of the Charlo doubleheader set to go down on pay-per-view, John Riel is going to be back in action in defense of his WBO title against Duke Micah. But afterwards, he wants to move up in weight, lock horns with the former WBC champion, Luis Neri. That effectively puts the kibosh on any future plans of facing Naoya Inoue.
That's a shame.
Casimiro versus Neri has all the makings of a good fight, though there wouldn't be as much on the line in that fight as there would have been in the Inoue fight, as the Inoue fight would have been a fight between two world champions.
So we're getting Jason Maloney instead.
If I'm being honest, I'm just happy to see Naoya Inoue getting back out there with somebody, anybody, at this point. That's set to be going down on October 31st, ESPN Plus. Overall, this is a solid schedule of fights for the upcoming month, and I look forward to it. Some more than others, but better still, I will be watching.